Let us pray. Gracious and loving Lord, now speak your words of life to each of us. Help us to hear them anew, and through the speaking of your word, renew each of us. And dear Lord, push me aside, and as I speak, Lord, remind me that if these people knew me as you know me, they wouldn't listen to a word I have to say. All this we pray and ask in Jesus' most precious and holy name. Amen. It's a time-worn tale. It's a tale and a story told way too often. It's a story that's a part of many of our lives. It may be a part of your life. It certainly is a part of my life. Many of us experience this story in one way or another. It's the story of Hyman Brodsky and Lewis Kramer. They grew up together, ran around in the same neighborhood, went to the same school, were best of friends in many regards. So you can imagine how happy they were when they discovered that they worked in the same office building, one in accounting and the other in insurance, these best of friends. But then one day it happened. Nobody's quite sure how or what was said, but they had a disagreement. They had a falling out. Emotions rose to their height and words were said, and they quit talking to one another. Even though on many days they would run into each other, working in the same building. It was told amongst fellow workers that if the two of them, Hyman and Lewis, arrived and were in the elevator, they would talk to others, but they would never, never, ever talk to each other. In fact, many observed when they were on the elevator alone that they would do as many of us do on the elevator. They'd look up at the numbers, avoiding eye contact or down at their feet, but not once would a syllable or an acknowledgement be made of each other. 50 years! 50 years these two best friends refused to talk to one another. Grace, acceptance, forgiveness, they're great concepts, aren't they? We sing about them in a few moments. We'll sing of Amazing Grace, but are they practical? Is forgiveness even possible? Is grace humanly achievable? With God's help, can we lead and live grace-filled lives? Paul would seem to say so. In his letter to the Colossians, in fact, through all of his letters, Paul is continually inviting you and me to grow up into the full maturity of Christ. And in this passage in particular, Paul is reminding you and me that we don't need anything else but Jesus Christ. Theologians say that the grace of Christ is sufficient, all sufficient for each of us, for you and for me, that the good news really is good news for you and for me. Look how he puts it, starting in verse 13. If you have your Bibles, I invite you to open to them. These are some powerful words. Remember, back in those days, they didn't have cameras to record everything. Now you got to be careful what you do, because chances are somebody's recording it, right? But we should be careful what we do anyhow, because we learned a couple weeks ago, God's an undercover boss. But back then, they didn't have those sorts of things, so authors would often create a visual picture, and I think this is one of the most powerful pictures in all of Paul's writings. Here Paul says, starting in verse 13, he says, "And when you were dead in trespasses and the uncircumcision of your flesh, God made you alive together with him. He forgave us just part of our trespasses or sins." No, it says he forgave us all our trespasses, erasing the record against us with his legal demands. He set all of this aside and he nailed it to the cross. He disarmed powers and authorities, demonstrating that God's grace comes to us when we're weak, when we're at our weakest. We were talking in Bible study a week or so ago about the upcoming Holy Week and some of the practices of this church and other churches. And some of the members of the class were talking about a time they had that was very moving, left an indelible impression. It was a Good Friday service, and maybe some of you have been part of a Good Friday service like that, but during the service, a cross was set up, and then in the service, the pastor asked people to write down their sins or their trespasses, and then to walk forward, grab a hammer and nail, and nail that against the cross, leaving it there. Powerful image, isn't it? And really true to Paul's words in Colossians. Do you believe that you're forgiven? Do you really believe? Do you and I know that we're forgiven, saved by grace? Do we trust in the sufficiency of Jesus Christ, that he's nailed those sins, our trespasses, past, present, and future, upon the cross for all time? That's what he does. Paul says as much. I'm reminded of the story of a Catholic archbishop who had an interaction with a woman. The woman had been seeing visions of Jesus. And of course, it was creating quite a bit of stir in the community and in the church. And finally, they asked the archbishop to come and discern what was really occurring here. So he came and talked to the woman. He said, "Are you seeing visions of Jesus?" And she said, "Oh yeah, he comes and he talks to me." Well, he thought he'd figured out a fail-safe plan to correct how crazy this woman really was. He said, "Well, then do this for me. If you're really seeing visions, the next time you see a vision, ask Jesus which sins I confessed in confessional." Well, he thought that that was an end to it. But he received a call a week or so later. "Now, this isn't right." So he went and talked to the woman, and he said, "Did you see a vision of Jesus?" And she said, "Oh, yes, I saw a vision of Jesus." Then he thought he had it. "Well, then what sins, what did he say about my sins?" And she said, "He just said one thing. I can't remember. I can't remember." Jesus cannot remember your sins and mine. One of Jeff's favorite passages he's reminded the choir of often is Psalm 103. And there's a powerful image that reminds you and me, just as Paul does in Colossians, that our transgressions are forgiven. And Psalm 103, starting on verse 8, the author David, we're told, and if somebody knew something about sin, it was David, right? And he says these words. He says, "The Lord is merciful and gracious, slow to anger and abounding in steadfast love. He will not always accuse, nor will he keep his anger forever. He does not deal with us according to our sins, nor repay us according to our iniquities. For as high as the heavens are above the earth, so great is the steadfast love of God towards those who fear him. As far as the east is from the west, this far he removes our transgressions from us as a father and a child." That's nailed home to the cross, isn't it? Forgetting them no more. You see, seemingly in this congregation, there were some folks who came in amongst those young Christians, and they had experienced the love and the grace of Jesus Christ, and they came into that church, that early communion, and they started to add to what Jesus had done. They were saying, "You need to do this, or you need to do that, or you need to do this to really experience the fullness of Christ's grace, his true sufficiency." And Paul is saying, "No, that's not the case." Some think that they might have been Jewish believers who were saying, "You need to practice the Old Testament codes and the laws." And Paul is saying, "No, his grace is sufficient for you. He nailed your transgressions and mine on the cross, dead, gone, forever, forgotten, as far as the east is from the west." Do you and I believe that? Easy to talk about it. whole lot more difficult to practice. How often do we, in maybe small ways but significant ways, think that we need to add to Christ's forgiveness? I just need to do this. I just don't feel right. I know I'm not. And we add. How often do we put stipulations on young believers? They're full of the grace of Christ, and instead of just letting God work with them where they're at and do what He does, well, you've got to do this, or you've got to do that, or you've got to do that to be in good standing with the church. How often do you and I just not forgive ourselves? Oh, I know God's forgiven me, but I can't forgive myself. There are things in my life where I go, dummy, 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 why'd you do that? That's Dwayne. That's not God. He's nailed on the cross. I have more trouble forgiving myself than God does in Jesus Christ. What does that say? I'm not accepting your grace. Maybe this morning you're one of those people, you've been beating yourself up over and over and over again. Let go of it. Nail it to the cross. Forgive yourself. Christ has forgiven you. How often are you and I like that? Or our lives don't live out of that grace, which is a denial of grace, isn't it? What did Jesus say? Forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. Oh God, I know you forgive that person, but don't ask me to forgive them. You know that feeling? And all of those, in one way or another, are adding or detracting from the sufficiency of Jesus Christ. And Paul says he's nailed them against the cross. Let go. Forgive yourself. Don't add to Jesus. Just let him embrace you. Live into and out of his grace. One theologian captures it well. He says, when it comes to a gift, there are kind of four responses we can do. One thing we can do when somebody offers us a gift is simply refuse it. In some ways, that's the ultimate insult, isn't it? I remember working with a family that had lots of family troubles and disagreement within the family, and it was around Christmas. I remember one of the family members sent gifts, Christmas gifts, to another family member. That family member just said, return to sender, and sent them back. A lot of people do that with God's grace in Jesus Christ. They just return it back to sender. Don't want it. Don't want it to change me. Don't believe in it. Don't want any part. You can refuse a gift, right? That's one thing you do. One thing you do is receive a gift with guilt. I don't deserve it. I'm not good enough. I'll take it. Is that really receiving the gift? How many of us walk around like that? One thing you can do is take a gift for granted, can't you? Bonhoeffer calls that cheap grace. We can cheapen Christ's grace. One of the things I know I've been forgiven of, but I look forward to seeing my grandpa and grandma someday, is that I have one of those things that gnaws in the back of my mind where I took for granted a gift that my grandparents had given to me. Grandpa and grandma were older in life, and I'd gotten to know them real well, and grandpa purchased an old beat-up boat, and he said, bring that boat up, and we're going to fix it. And this was the day we put a casting deck in it, tore out all the seats. Grandpa, you know, he did most of the work. We painted it, we put carpet in it, put on a fish locator, all of those things. My grandma, Lord, she was dying of emphysema. She was nice enough to sew up an old cover for it. I fished out of that boat 4 or 5 times and sold it. Young, needed something bigger, better. I think back, dumb, taking for granted a gift. How often do we do that with Jesus Christ? Or we can do the one thing that I think Paul asks us to do when it comes to a gift. We can simply receive it. What do mom and dad tell us when you get a gift? You just say, thank you. Christianity begins with those simple words. Thank you, God. And then live out of that grace. This is at the center of faith, and it's an old gospel message that I'm preaching, but it's important, especially as we enter the season of Advent. Paul Tillich, one of the great theologians of the last century, preached a sermon that was well known. It was entitled these words, "Accept That You're Accepted." Good words. It's basically what I'm saying. We need to accept that we're accepted. Now, mind you, accepting, or, you know, I can accept something, that doesn't mean I approve of it, right? Now, we're going to talk about those things that God doesn't approve coming up in Lent. We're going to talk a lot about sin. I'm going to talk about seven sins. You may know where I'm going. But I'll invite you back next week as we talk about those seven. But as we look at sin in our lives, we have to remember that it's a part of God's acceptance. We'll be looking at what God doesn't approve, but God still accepts us and loves us. That's the message for today, and we need to keep in mind as we enter the Lenten season. Have you accepted that you're accepted? Really know the grace? Are you living out of that grace? Are you sharing it? Does it motivate all that you do and say? That's the grace of Jesus Christ. That's what Marcia and Michael discovered. They were freshmen at the University of Massachusetts in 1968, and they met one another, and there was that thing. How many of us remember when we were involved, that thing? It was just there. And they discovered that they had some of the same interests. They both had played in band in their respective schools. They had some of the same friends. And that romance just started to grow. Then in 1974, they made the announcement to one and all that they were going to get married. And it was a wonderful day of celebration. And they set the date, but one problem. Really, two problems. Probably already guessed, but Marcia Lockwood's grandfather was Hyman Brodsky, and Michael Kramer's grandfather was Lewis Kramer. They didn't know what to do. But God took care of that. God's grace often does. God's at work outside of these doors in mysterious and glorious ways, but Hyman and Lewis were riding up the elevator, and God's grace broke through. We're not sure which one said it, but it went something like this. One of them said to the other, "Well, it looks like the kids are going to get married." And the other one said, "Yes, it looks that way, doesn't it?" And those words melted the ice of hostility. Shortly thereafter, they were both invited to an engagement party, and they arrived, and Marcia puts it this way, and both of them were sitting there next to each other all through the party, and they were talking about their days back in school when they were boys, and it was as if no time had passed, no 50 years of silence. What changed it all? Love. The love of a couple, really. Isn't that what changes it all for each of us? The love of God and Jesus Christ melts our hearts, changes the way we look at the world, and how we respond to those around us. Somebody gives you a gift. What do? You just say, "Thank you. You are forgiven in Jesus Christ. Hear the good news." Amen. Let us pray. Gracious and loving Lord, we thank you for your grace given to each of us. That's why we gather each and every Sunday. Help us to not add to that grace, to think that we have to earn it, to put stipulations on others, but help us just to receive the gift with thanks. And to live out of that grace as we go forth into the world, a world of much ungrace and unforgiveness. And in those challenging areas in our lives, Lord, may your grace continue to work in us and soften our hearts and melt that ice. And the sooner the better, Lord. All this we pray and ask in Jesus' most precious name, who taught us to pray, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom,